Susy, A Story of the Plains. By Bret Harte. Podcast 6 of 6. Chapter 12. Nowhere had the long season of flowers brought such glory as to the broad plains and slopes of Robles Rancho. By some fortuitous chance of soil, or flood, or drifting pollen, the three terraces had each taken a distinct and separate blossom and tint of color. The straggling line of corral, the crumbling wall of the old garden, the outlying chapel, and even the brown walls of the casa itself, were half sunken in the tall racemes of crowding lupins, until from the distance they seemed to be slowly settling in the profundity of a dark blue sea. The second terrace was a league-long flow of gray and gold daisies, in which the cattle dazedly wandered mid-leg deep. A perpetual sunshine of yellow dandelions lay upon the third. The gentle slope to the dark green Canada was a broad cataract of crimson poppies. Everywhere where water had stood, great patches of color had taken its place. It seemed as if the rains had ceased only that the broken heavens might drop flowers. Never before had its beauty a beauty that seemed built upon a cruel, youthful, obliterating forgetfulness of the past struck Clarence as keenly as when he had made up his mind that he must leave the place forever. For the tale of his mischance and ill fortune, as told by Hopkins, was unfortunately true. When he discovered that in his desire to save Peyton's house by the purchase of the sister's title he himself had been the victim of a gigantic fraud, he accepted the loss of the greater part of his fortune with resignation, and was even satisfied by the thought that he had at least effected the possession of the property for Mrs. Peyton. But when he found that those of his tenants who had bought under him had acquired only a dubious possession of their lands and no title, he had unhesitatingly reimbursed them for their improvements with the last of his capital. Only the lawless Gilroy had good-humoredly declined. The quiet acceptance of the others did not, unfortunately, preclude their settled belief that Clarence had participated in the fraud, and that even now his restitution was making a dangerous precedent, subversive of the best interests of the state, and discouraging to immigration. Some doubted his sanity. Only one, struck with the sincerity of his motive, hesitated to take his money, with a look of commiseration on his face. "Are you not satisfied?" asked Clarence, smiling. "Yes, but..." "But what?" "Nothing. Only I was thinking that a man like you must feel awful lonesome in Caffourney." Lonely he was, indeed, but his loneliness was not the loss of fortune nor what it might bring. Perhaps he had never fully realized his wealth, it had been an accident rather than a custom of his life, and when it had failed in the only test he had made of its power, it is to be feared that he only sentimentally regretted it. It was too early yet for him to comprehend the veiled blessings of the catastrophe in its merciful disruption of habits and ways of life. His loneliness was still the hopeless solitude left by vanished ideals and overthrown idols. He was satisfied that he had never cared for Susy, but he still cared for the belief that he had. After the discovery of Pedro's body that fatal morning, a brief but emphatic interview between himself and Mrs. McCloskey had followed. He had insisted upon her immediately accompanying Susy and himself to Mrs. Peyton in San Francisco. Horror-stricken and terrified at the catastrophe, and frightened by the strange looks of the excited servants, they did not dare to disobey him. He had left them with Mrs. Peyton in the briefest preliminary interview, during which he spoke only of the catastrophe, shielding the woman from the presumption of having provoked it, and urging only the importance of settling the question of guardianship at once. It was odd that Mrs. Peyton had been less disturbed than he imagined she would be at even his charitable version of Susie's unfaithfulness to her, it even seemed to him that she had already suspected it. But as he was about to withdraw to leave her to meet them alone, she had stopped him suddenly. "What would you advise me to do?" It was his first interview with her since the revelation of his own feelings. He looked into the pleading, troubled eyes of the woman he now knew he had loved, and stammered. "You alone can judge. Only you must remember that one cannot force an affection any more than one can prevent it." He felt himself blushing, and, conscious of the construction of his words, he even fancied that she was displeased. "Then you have no preference," she said, a little impatiently. "None." She made a slight gesture with her handsome shoulders, but she only said, "I should have liked to have pleased you in this," and turned coldly away. He had left without knowing the result of the interview, but a few days later he received a letter from her stating that she had allowed Susy to return to her aunt, and that she had resigned all claims to her guardianship. "It seemed to be a foregone conclusion," she wrote, "and although I cannot think such a change will be for her permanent welfare, it is her present wish, and who knows, indeed, if the change will be permanent. I have not allowed the legal question to interfere with my judgment, although her friends must know that she forfeits any claim upon the estate by her action, but at the same time, in the event of her suitable marriage, I should try to carry out what I believe would have been Mr. Peyton's wishes." There were a few lines of postscript: "It seems to me that the change would leave you more free to consult your own wishes in regard to continuing your friendship with Susy, and upon such a footing as may please you. I judge from Mrs. McCloskey's conversation that she believed you thought you were only doing your duty in reporting to me, and that the circumstances had not altered the good terms in which you all three formerly stood." Clarence had dropped the letter with a burning indignation that seemed to sting his eyes until a scalding moisture hid the words before him. What might not Susy have said? What exaggeration of his affection was she not capable of suggesting? He recalled Mrs. McCloskey, and remembered her easy acceptance of him as Susie's lover. What had they told Mrs. Peyton? What must be her opinion of his deceit towards herself? It was hard enough to bear this before he knew he loved her. It was intolerable now. And this is what she meant when she suggested that he should renew his old terms with Susy. It was for him that this ill-disguised, scornful generosity in regard to Susie's pecuniary expectations was intended. What should he do? He would write to her, and indignantly deny any clandestine affection for Susy. But could he do that, in honor, in truthfulness? Would it not be better to write and confess all? Yes, everything. Fortunately for his still boyish impulsiveness, it was at this time that the discovery of his own financial ruin came to him. The inquest on the body of Pedro Valdez and the confession of his confidant had revealed the facts of the fraudulent title and forged testamentary documents. Although it was correctly believed that Pedro had met his death in an escapade of gallantry or intrigue, the coroner's jury had returned a verdict of accidental death, and the lesser scandal was lost in the wider, far-spreading disclosure of fraud. When he had resolved to assume all the liabilities of his purchase, he was obliged to write to Mrs. Peyton and confess his ruin. But he was glad to remind her that it did not alter her status or security. He had only given her the possession, and she would revert to her original and now uncontested title. But as there was now no reason for his continuing the stewardship, and as he must adopt some profession and seek his fortune elsewhere, he begged her to relieve him of his duty. Albeit written with a throbbing heart and suffused eyes, it was a plain, businesslike, and practical letter. Her reply was equally cool and matter-of-fact. She was sorry to hear of his losses, although she could not agree with him that they could logically sever his present connection with the rancho, or that, placed upon another and distinctly business footing, the occupation would not be as remunerative to him as any other. But, of course, if he had a preference for some more independent position, that was another question, although he would forgive her for using the privilege of her years to remind him that his financial and business success had not yet justified his independence. She would also advise him not to decide hastily, or, at least, to wait until she had again thoroughly gone over her husband's papers with her lawyer, in reference to the old purchase of the sister's title, and the conditions under which it was bought. She knew that Mr. Brandt would not refuse this as a matter of business, nor would that friendship, which she valued so highly, allow him to imperil the possession of the rancho by leaving it at such a moment. As soon as she had finished the examination of the papers, she would write again. Her letter seemed to leave him no hope, if, indeed, he had ever indulged in any. It was the practical kindliness of a woman of business, nothing more. As to the examination of her husband's papers, that was a natural precaution. He alone knew that they would give no record of a transaction which had never occurred. He briefly replied that his intention to seek another situation was unchanged, but that he would cheerfully await the arrival of his successor. 2 weeks passed. Then Mr. Sanderson, Mrs. Peyton's lawyer, arrived, bringing an apologetic note from Mrs. Peyton. She was so sorry her business was still delayed, but as she had felt that she had no right to detain him entirely at Robles, she had sent to Mr. Sanderson to temporarily relieve him, that he might be free to look around him or visit San Francisco in reference to his own business, only extracting a promise from him that he would return to Robles to meet her at the end of the week, before settling upon anything. The bitter smile with which Clarence had read thus far suddenly changed. Some mysterious touch of unbusinesslike but womanly hesitation, that he had never noticed in her previous letters, gave him a faint sense of pleasure, as if her note had been perfumed. He had availed himself of the offer. It was on this visit to Sacramento that he had accidentally discovered the marriage of Susy and Hooker. "It's a great deal better business for her to have a husband in the profession if she's a-goin' to stick to it," said his informant, Mrs. McCloskey, "and she's nothing if she ain't business and profesh, Mr. Brandt. I never see a girl that was born for the stage. Yes, you might say jest cut out o' the boards of the stage as that girl Susy is. And that's jest what's the matter, and you know it, and I know it, and there you are." It was with these experiences that Clarence was today re-entering the wooded and rocky gateway of the Rancho from the high road of the Canada, but as he cantered up the first slope, through the drift of scarlet poppies that almost obliterated the track, and the blue and yellow blooms of the terraces again broke upon his view, he thought only of Mrs. Peyton's pleasure in this changed aspect of her old home. She had told him of it once before, and of her delight in it, and he had once thought how happy he should be to see it with her. The servant who took his horse told him that the Señora had arrived that morning from Santa Inés, bringing with her the two Señoritas Hernandez from the Rancho of Los Canjos, and that other guests were expected. And there was the Señor Sanderson and his Reverence Padre Esteban. Truly an affair of hospitality, the first since the Padrón died. Whatever dream Clarence might have had of opportunities for confidential interview was rudely dispelled. Yet Mrs. Peyton had left orders to be informed at once of Don Clarencio's arrival. As he crossed the patio and stepped upon the corridor, he fancied he already detected in the internal arrangements the subtle influence of Mrs. Peyton's taste and the indefinable domination of the mistress. For an instant he thought of anticipating the servant and seeking her in the boudoir, but some instinct withheld him, and he turned into the study which he had used as an office. It was empty, a few embers glimmered on the hearth. At the same moment there was a light step behind him, and Mrs. Peyton entered and closed the door behind her. She was very beautiful. Although paler and thinner, there was an odd sort of animation about her, so unlike her usual repose that it seemed almost feverish. "I thought we could talk together a few moments before the guests arrive. The house will be presently so full, and my duties as hostess commence. I was about to seek you in the boudoir," hesitated Clarence. She gave an impatient shiver. "Good heavens, not there. I shall never go there again. I should fancy every time I looked out of the window that I saw the head of that man between the bars. No. I am only thankful that I wasn't here at the time, and that I can keep my remembrance of the dear old place unchanged." She checked herself a little abruptly, and then added somewhat irrelevantly but cheerfully, "Well, you have been away? What have you done?" "Nothing," said Clarence. "Then you have kept your promise," she said, with the same nervous hilarity. "I have returned here without making any other engagement," he said gravely, "but I have not altered my determination." She shrugged her shoulders again, or, as it seemed, the skin of her tightly fitting black dress above them, with the sensitive shiver of a highly groomed horse, and moved to the hearth as if for warmth, put her slim, slippered foot upon the low fender, drawing, with a quick hand, the whole width of her skirt behind her until it clingingly accented the long, graceful curve from her hip to her feet. All this was so unlike her usual fastidiousness and repose that he was struck by it. With her eyes on the glowing embers of the hearth, and tentatively advancing her toe to its warmth and drawing it away, she said. Of course, you must please yourself. I am afraid I have no right except that of habit and custom to keep you here, and you know, she added, with an only half-withheld bitterness, that they are not always very effective with young people who prefer to have the ordering of their own lives. But I have something still to tell you before you finally decide. I have, as you know, been looking over Mr. Peyton's papers very carefully. Well, as a result, I find, Mr. Brandt, that there is no record whatever of his wonderfully providential purchase of the sister's title from you, that he never entered into any written agreement with you, and never paid you a cent, and that, furthermore, his papers show me that he never even contemplated it, nor, indeed, even knew of your owning the title when he died. Yes, Mr. Brandt, it was all to your foresight and prudence, and your generosity alone, that we owe our present possession of the rancho. When you helped us into that awful window, it was your house we were entering, and if it had been you, and not those wretches, who had chosen to shut the doors on us after the funeral, we could never have entered here again. Don't deny it, Mr. Brandt. I have suspected it a long time, and when you spoke of changing your position, I determined to find out if it wasn't I who had to leave the house rather than you. One moment, please. And I did find out, and it was I don't speak, please, yet. And now, she said, with a quick return to her previous nervous hilarity, knowing this, as you did, and knowing, too, that I would know it when I examined the papers, don't speak, I'm not through yet. Don't you think that it was just a little cruel for you to try to hurry me, and make me come here instead of your coming to me in San Francisco, when I gave you leave for that purpose? But, Mrs. Peyton, gasped Clarence. Please don't interrupt me, said the lady, with a touch of her old imperiousness, for in a moment I must join my guests. When I found you wouldn't tell me, and left it to me to find out, I could only go away as I did, and really leave you to control what I believed was your own property. And I thought, too, that I understood your motives, and, to be frank with you, that worried me, for I believed I knew the disposition and feelings of a certain person better than yourself. One moment, broke out Clarence, you must hear me, now. Foolish and misguided as that purchase may have been, I swear to you I had only one motive in making it, to save the homestead for you and your husband, who had been my first and earliest benefactors. What the result of it was, you, as a businesswoman, know, your friends know, your lawyer will tell you the same. You owe me nothing. I have given you nothing but the repossession of this property, which any other man could have done, and perhaps less stupidly than I did. I would not have forced you to come here to hear this if I had dreamed of your suspicions, or even if I had simply understood that you would see me in San Francisco as I passed through. Passed through? Where were you going? She said quickly. To Sacramento. The abrupt change in her manner startled him to a recollection of Susy, and he blushed. She bit her lips, and moved towards the window. Then you saw her, she said, turning suddenly towards him. The inquiry of her beautiful eyes was more imperative than her speech. Clarence recognized quickly what he thought was his cruel blunder in touching the half-healed wound of separation. But he had gone too far to be other than perfectly truthful now. Yes, I saw her on the stage, he said, with a return of his boyish earnestness, and I learned something which I wanted you to first hear from me. She is married and to Mr. Hooker, who is in the same theatrical company with her. But I want you to think, as I honestly do, that it is the best for her. She has married in her profession, which is a great protection and a help to her success, and she has married a man who can look lightly upon certain qualities in her that others might not be so lenient to. His worst faults are on the surface, and will wear away in contact with the world, and he looks up to her as his superior. I gathered this from her friend, for I did not speak with her myself, I did not go there to see her. But as I expected to be leaving you soon, I thought it only right that as I was the humble means of first bringing her into your life, I should bring you this last news, which I suppose takes her out of it forever. Only I want you to believe that you have nothing to regret, and that she is neither lost nor unhappy." The expression of suspicious inquiry on her face when he began changed gradually to perplexity as he continued, and then relaxed into a faint, peculiar smile. But there was not the slightest trace of that pain, wounded pride, indignation, or anger, that he had expected to see upon it. "That means, I suppose, Mr. Brandt, that you no longer care for her." The smile had passed, yet she spoke now with a half-real, half-affected archness that was also unlike her. "It means," said Clarence with a white face, but a steady voice, "that I care for her now as much as I ever cared for her, no matter to what folly it once might have led me. But it means, also, that there was no time when I was not able to tell it to you as frankly as I do now." "One moment, please," she interrupted, and turned quickly towards the door. She opened it and looked out. "I thought they were calling me and I must go now, Mr. Brandt." And without finishing my business either, or saying half I had intended to say. "But wait," she put her hand to her head in a pretty perplexity, "it's a moonlight night, and I'll propose after dinner a stroll in the gardens, and you can manage to walk a little with me." She stopped again, returned, said, "It was very kind of you to think of me at Sacramento," held out her hand, allowed it to remain for an instant, cool but acquiescent, in his warmer grasp, and with the same odd youthfulness of movement and gesture slipped out of the door. An hour later she was at the head of her dinner table, serene, beautiful, and calm, in her elegant mourning, provokingly inaccessible in the sweet deliberation of her widowed years. Padre Esteban was at her side with a local magnate, who had known Peyton and his wife, while Donna Rosita and a pair of liquid-tongued, childlike señoritas were near Clarence and Sanderson. To the priest Mrs. Peyton spoke admiringly of the changes in the rancho and the restoration of the mission chapel, and together they had commended Clarence from the level of their superior passionless reserve and years. Clarence felt hopelessly young and hopelessly lonely, the naive prattle of the young girls beside him appeared infantine. In his abstraction, he heard Mrs. Peyton allude to the beauty of the night, and propose that after coffee and chocolate the ladies should put on their wraps and go with her to the old garden. Clarence raised his eyes, she was not looking at him, but there was a slight consciousness in her face that was not there before, and the faintest color in her cheek, still lingering, no doubt, from the excitement of conversation. It was a cool, tranquil, dewless night when they at last straggled out, mere black and white patches in the colorless moonlight. The brilliancy of the flower-hued landscape was subdued under its passive, pale austerity, even the gray and gold of the second terrace seemed dulled and confused. At any other time Clarence might have lingered over this strange effect, but his eyes followed only a tall figure, in a long striped burnous, that moved gracefully beside the sout-honored priest. As he approached, it turned towards him. "Ah, here you are. I just told Father Esteban that you talked of leaving tomorrow, and that he would have to excuse me a few moments while you showed me what you had done to the old garden." She moved beside him, and, with a hesitation that was not unlike a more youthful timidity, slipped her hand through his arm. It was for the first time, and, without thinking, he pressed it impulsively to his side. I have already intimated that Clarence's reserve was at times qualified by singular directness. A few steps carried them out of hearing, a few more, and they seemed alone in the world. The long adobe wall glanced away emptily beside them, and was lost, the black shadows of the knotted pear trees were beneath their feet. They began to walk with the slight affectation of treading the shadows as if they were patterns on a carpet. Clarence was voiceless, and yet he seemed to be moving beside a spirit that must be first addressed. But it was flesh and blood nevertheless. "I interrupted you in something you were saying when I left the office," she said quietly. "I was speaking of Susy," returned Clarence eagerly, "and..." "Then you needn't go on," interrupted Mrs. Peyton quickly. "I understand you, and believe you. I would rather talk of something else. We have not yet arranged how I can make restitution to you for the capital you sank in saving this place. You will be reasonable, Mr. Brandt, and not leave me with the shame and pain of knowing that you ruined yourself for the sake of your old friends. For it is no more a sentimental idea of mine to feel in this way than it is a fair and sensible one for you to imply that a mere quibble of construction absolves me from responsibility. Mr. Sanderson himself admits that the repossession you gave us is a fair and legal basis for any arrangement of sharing or division of the property with you, that might enable you to remain here and continue the work you have so well begun. Have you no suggestion, or must it come from me, Mr. Brandt? Neither. Let us not talk of that now. She did not seem to notice the boyish doggedness of his speech, except so far as it might have increased her inconsequent and nervously pitched levity. Then suppose we speak of the Mrs. Hernandez, with whom you scarcely exchanged a word at dinner, and whom I invited for you and your fluent Spanish. They are charming girls, even if they are a little stupid. But what can I do? If I am to live here, I must have a few young people around me, if only to make the place cheerful for others. Do you know I have taken a great fancy to Miss Rogers, and have asked her to visit me? I think she is a good friend of yours, although perhaps she is a little shy. What's the matter? You have nothing against her, have you? Clarence had stopped short. They had reached the end of the pear tree shadows. A few steps more would bring them to the fallen south wall of the garden and the open moonlight beyond, but to the right an olive alley of deeper shadow diverged. No, he said, with slow deliberation, I have to thank Mary Rogers for having discovered something in me that I have been blindly, foolishly, and hopelessly struggling with. And, pray, what was that? Said Mrs. Peyton sharply. That I love you. Mrs. Peyton was fairly startled. The embarrassment of any truth is apt to be in its eternal abruptness, which no deviousness of tact or circumlocution of diplomacy has ever yet surmounted. Whatever had been in her heart, or mind, she was unprepared for this directness. The bolt had dropped from the sky, they were alone, there was nothing between the stars and the earth but herself and this man and this truth, it could not be overlooked, surmounted, or escaped from. A step or two more would take her out of the garden into the moonlight, but always into this awful frankness of blunt and outspoken nature. She hesitated, and turned the corner into the olive shadows. It was, perhaps, more dangerous, but less shameless, and less like truckling. And the appallingly direct Clarence instantly followed. I know you will despise me, hate me, and, perhaps, worst of all, disbelieve me, but I swear to you, now, that I have always loved you, yes, always. When first I came here, it was not to see my old playmate, but you, for I had kept the memory of you as I first saw you when a boy, and you have always been my ideal. I have thought of, dreamed of, worshipped, and lived for no other woman. Even when I found Susy again, grown up here at your side, even when I thought that I might, with your consent, marry her, it was that I might be with you always, that I might be a part of your home, your family, and have a place with her in your heart, for it was you I loved, and you only. Don't laugh at me, Mrs. Peyton, it is the truth, the whole truth, I am telling you. God help me. If she only could have laughed harshly, ironically, or even mercifully and kindly. But it would not come. And she burst out. I am not laughing. Good heavens, don't you see? It is me you are making ridiculous. You ridiculous, he said in a momentarily choked, half-stupefied voice. You a beautiful woman, my superior in everything, the mistress of these lands where I am only steward made ridiculous, not by my presumption, but by my confession? Was the saint you just now admired in Father Esteban's chapel ridiculous because of the peon clowns who were kneeling before it? Hush! This is wicked! Stop! She felt she was now on firm ground, and made the most of it in voice and manner. She must draw the line somewhere, and she would draw it between passion and impiety. Not until I have told you all, and I must before I leave you. I loved you when I came here even when your husband was alive. Don't be angry, Mrs. Peyton, he would not, and need not, have been angry, he would have pitied the foolish boy, who, in the very innocence and ignorance of his passion, might have revealed it to him as he did to everybody but one. And yet, I sometimes think you might have guessed it, had you thought of me at all. It must have been on my lips that day I sat with you in the boudoir. I know that I was filled with it and with you, with your presence, with your beauty, your grace of heart and mind, yes, Mrs. Peyton, even with your own unrequited love for Susy. Only, then, I knew not what it was. But I think I can tell you what it was then, and now, said Mrs. Peyton, recovering her nervous little laugh, though it died a moment after on her lips. I remember it very well. You told me then that I reminded you of your mother. Well, I am not old enough to be your mother, Mr. Brandt, but I am old enough to have been, and might have been, the mother of your wife. That was what you meant then, that is what you mean now. I was wrong to accuse you of trying to make me ridiculous. I ask your pardon. Let us leave it as it was that day in the boudoir, as it is now. Let me still remind you of your mother. I know she must have been a good woman to have had so good a son, and when you have found some sweet young girl to make you happy, come to me for a mother's blessing, and we will laugh at the recollection and misunderstanding of this evening. Her voice did not, however, exhibit that exquisite maternal tenderness which the beatific vision ought to have called up, and the persistent voice of Clarence could not be evaded in the shadow. I said you reminded me of my mother, he went on at her side, because I knew her and lost her only as a child. She never was anything to me but a memory, and yet an ideal of all that was sweet and lovable in woman. Perhaps it was a dream of what she might have been when she was as young in years as you. If it pleases you still to misunderstand me, it may please you also to know that there is a reminder of her even in this. I have no remembrance of a word of affection from her, nor a caress. I have been as hopeless in my love for her who was my mother, as of the woman I would make my wife. But you have seen no one, you know no one, you are young, you scarcely know your own self. You will forget this, you will forget me. And if I should listen to you, what would the world say, what would you yourself say a few years hence? Oh, be reasonable. Think of it, it would be so wild, so mad. So utterly ridiculous. In proof of its ludicrous quality, two tears escaped her eyes in the darkness. But Clarence caught the white flash of her withdrawn handkerchief in the shadow, and captured her returning hand. It was trembling, but did not struggle, and presently hushed itself to rest in his. I'm not only a fool but a brute, he said in a lower voice. Forgive me. I have given you pain, you, for whom I would have died. They had both stopped. He was still holding her sleeping hand. His arm had stolen around the burnous so softly that it followed the curves of her figure as lightly as a fold of the garment, and was presumably unfelt. Grief has its privileges, and suffering exonerates a questionable situation. In another moment her fair head might have dropped upon his shoulder. But an approaching voice uprose in the adjoining broad alley. It might have been the world speaking through the voice of the lawyer Sanderson. Yes, he is a good fellow, and an intelligent fellow, too, but a perfect child in his experience of mankind. They both started, but Mrs. Peyton's hand suddenly woke up and grasped his firmly. Then she said in a higher, but perfectly level tone. Yes, I think with you we had better look at it again in the sunlight tomorrow. But here come our friends, they have probably been waiting for us to join them and go in. *. The wholesome freshness of early morning was in the room when Clarence awoke, cleared and strengthened. His resolution had been made. He would leave the rancho that morning, to enter the world again and seek his fortune elsewhere. This was only right to her, whose future it should never be said he had imperiled by his folly and inexperience, and if, in a year or two of struggle he could prove his right to address her again, he would return. He had not spoken to her since they had parted in the garden, with the grim truths of the lawyer ringing in his ears, but he had written a few lines of farewell, to be given to her after he had left. He was calm in his resolution, albeit a little pale and hollow-eyed for it. He crept downstairs in the gray twilight of the scarce awakened house, and made his way to the stables. Saddling his horse, and mounting, he paced forth into the crisp morning air. The sun, just risen, was everywhere bringing out the fresh color of the flower-strewn terraces, as the last night's shadows, which had hidden them, were slowly beaten back. He cast a last look at the brown adobe quadrangle of the quiet house, just touched with the bronzing of the sun, and then turned his face towards the highway. As he passed the angle of the old garden he hesitated, but, strong in his resolution, he put the recollection of last night behind him, and rode by without raising his eyes. Clarence. It was her voice. He wheeled his horse. She was standing behind the grill in the old wall as he had seen her standing on the day he had ridden to his rendezvous with Susy. A Spanish mantle was thrown over her head and shoulders, as if she had dressed hastily, and had run out to intercept him while he was still in the stable. Her beautiful face was pale in its black hooded recess, and there were faint circles around her lovely eyes. "You were going without saying goodbye," she said softly. She passed her slim white hand between the grating. Clarence leaped to the ground, caught it, and pressed it to his lips. But he did not let it go. "No, no," she said, struggling to withdraw it. "It is better as it is, as you have decided it to be. Only I could not let you go thus without a word. There now go, Clarence, go. Please. Don't you see I am behind these bars? Think of them as the years that separate us, my poor, dear, foolish boy. Think of them as standing between us, growing closer, heavier, and more cruel and hopeless as the years go on. Ah, well. They had been good bars 150 years ago, when it was thought as necessary to repress the innocence that was behind them as the wickedness that was without. They had done duty in the convent at Santa Inez, and the monastery of Santa Barbara, and had been brought hither in Governor Micheltorena's time to keep the daughters of Robles from the insidious contact of the outer world, when they took the air in their cloistered pleasance. Guitars had tinkled against them in vain, and they had withstood the stress and storm of love tokens. But, like many other things which have had their day and time, they had retained their semblance of power, even while rattling loosely in their sockets, only because no one had ever thought of putting them to the test, and, in the strong hand of Clarence, assisted, perhaps, by the leaning figure of Mrs. Peyton, I grieve to say that the whole grill suddenly collapsed, became a frame of tinkling iron, and then clanked, bar by bar, into the road. Mrs. Peyton uttered a little cry and drew back, and Clarence, leaping the ruins, caught her in his arms. For a moment only, for she quickly withdrew from them, and although the morning sunlight was quite rosy on her cheeks, she said gravely, pointing to the dismantled opening, "I suppose you must stay now, for you never could leave me here alone and defenseless." He stayed. And with this fulfillment of his youthful dreams the romance of his young manhood seemed to be completed, and so closed the second volume of this trilogy. But what effect that fulfillment of youth had upon his maturer years, or the fortunes of those who were nearly concerned in it, may be told in a later and final chronicle.